Hello and welcome back to KubeCon CloudNativeCon North America 2025 from Cold Atlanta. I'm Rob Strechay, excited to have you on. And we have some returning guests and somebody who's new to the show. So I want to thank Brian Monroe, who's a senior software engineer for NVIDIA. I think people may have heard of your company before. You've been in the news a little bit.
Small company.
And then Venkat Ramakrishnan is back with us again, who's the VP and GM of Portworx by Pure Storage. Welcome on board, guys. I think this has been, besides being cold here, things are heating up on the floor here, we're getting going, and the hot stuff going on is with Kubernetes and how people are using it with AI and other things. But let's first, Brian, get to know you a little bit. You know, what is your team up to and your role at NVIDIA, and what do you work on?
So my team is involved in providing services and infrastructure for our farm team, and our farm team's responsible for providing the infrastructure for our R&D and our chip design and chip implementation. So my team specifically focuses a lot on enabling capabilities. One of them, one big part of that is our Kubernetes infrastructure. So we have both Kubernetes on-prem and Kubernetes in the cloud. My responsibilities typically focus on the on-prem Kubernetes and basically providing as much of a self-service turnkey environment for our application R&D developers and R&D application folks to be able to deploy their applications.
So you're an end user. So you're really in the day-to-day with like all the rest of the people here trying to figure things out. What is your container strategy look like going forward? Because I mean, again, like you said, you're dealing with the farm, funny enough, fabs and chip design and all that, you got to get things moving. It takes a long time for new chips to come about. But what is your container strategy as you look out into the future here?
So generally we are, I mean, we're definitely, I would say, a container first environment, right? So like we don't really have, in every aspect of our R&D group, we're trying to get out of sort of fixed infrastructure models, right? So every place where we can, you know, dynamically provision, dynamically allocate resources, stand up and tear down as quickly as possible, repurpose is really our goal, right? So, that's like getting rid of really simple things like, you know, jump host and bastion host, turn those in containers, right? In addition to our traditional workloads, like application workloads, you know, stateful and stateless workloads on Kubernetes that are used for all different kinds of things. Could be metrics collection, could be traditional business applications, could be whatever. Wherever there's a need for deploying something, we're looking at containers as the way to get that out there.
So why are you up here with Portworx?
Well, we're a Portworx customer.
Okay, well that, how does that play into this strategy of, you know, being container first, being Kubernetes native and?
So, I mean, obviously there's a number of things when you get into the container world that, you know, you've got to come up with some unique solutions for, right? So storage is a little bit unique in the container world, you know, networking is a little bit unique, some things like that, right? So resource management, all these things are areas that sort of change a little bit, and you have to adapt and come up with new solutions to meet those, right? So specifically in the storage world, so, you know, we started off, NVIDIA has typically been investing in the hardware. We would buy a lot of sort of like, you know, bare metal type servers, and then we would deploy those. And when we got into, you know, that was traditional for our, you know, our batch workloads that we ran in those environments. Then we got into Kubernetes. We were still sort of doing that model. So we got into, you know, sort of DAS storage and had lots of commodity infrastructure with DAS storage. And we needed to find a way to manage that storage effectively, right? And so we looked at several different vendors, and ultimately we aligned on Portworx as the right option for us.
Yeah, I mean, I look at it, there has to be, I mean, you know, interesting things and interesting feedback coming back to Portworx from the folks at NVIDIA. Tell us a little bit about what the journey has been from that, your side.
Yeah, I mean, we have been partners. I mean, we have been, working with NVIDIA even prior to the Pure acquisition of Portworx. They have been a long-term customer of us. Yeah. And, the platform team at NVIDIA, the Brian's team, supports a large number of developers and different development teams that do everything from chip design, firmware development, internal enterprise software development, AI training, and you know, a whole bunch of workloads that run on, you know, on Kubernetes and, you know, on Portworx, right? And this is, you know, essentially kind of the sweet spot use case for us, because Portworx delivers data management at scale for Kubernetes, but makes it self-service for application developers, right? Because you could build your code in your namespace, but you can, if you want to run data services, or if you want to, you're building a dev pod where you're like, you know, using a GPU for training, but you're developing your software, you don't need to ever file a ticket to get storage service, or like a file, block, or an object, because you're running Portworx, and it's available scoped to your namespace with multi-tenancy. That means you could have a team that's developing a whole bunch of, you know, like ASIC firmware, but another team that's developing, like doing AI training, can share the same Kubernetes infrastructure without ever stepping on each other's data, right? Yeah. So that's the level of multi-tenancy and shared service model that Portworx delivers. And these are teams that support a large number of developers with a few platform engineers, right? So we enable them to operate at scale, right? Yeah. It's been a phenomenal journey working with NVIDIA and learning with them as they evolve as well.
I can imagine. I mean, again, it's like there's no shortage that you guys have to go fast, but you also have to be secure and available. Kind of talk to how you know, the availability factors into what you're building there.
Right, so I think the big thing, you know, in terms of like delivering the solution to our stakeholders is that, you know, as we've talked about, it has to be like, we don't really want to get our hands into it, right? It needs to be, we stand it up, we layer on top of that our, you know, our delivery model, and then basically allow our teams to be able to, like, you know, allocate their namespaces, deploy their applications, deploy their, you know, persistent volumes and storage right there. They don't have to think about, you know, what's under the covers, right? And then the second part of that, once it's up and running, we need that availability, right? So we need to be able to, like, we take down, you know, a cluster, do maintenance. We need to be able to shift our workloads. We try to generally do a zero downtime maintenance, right? So we basically would take down one node in a cluster, do the upgrades, things like that. We shift the workloads around, you know, the Portworx storage infrastructure, you know, with replication spread across multiple nodes, allows us to move those workloads around in various locations without having to worry about, you know, taking down a specific business process or function, right?
So are these applications very ephemeral, or are they, some of them, long running, and what types of applications are on these pods?
We have both, right? Yeah. We have a lot of sort of like batch type workloads that, you know, run, you know, for a period of time each day, collect information or do some other workloads that's part of their, you know, part of the R&D process they might need to implement. We have others that run continuously. So it's a pretty diverse mix. And you know, so there's no real sort of specific type of application.
So when you look at this and you look at scalability, how does that factor into what you're doing as well?
I think from a standpoint of scalability is that we need to have, you know, the ability to scale out as needed, right? So we try to provide, to our stakeholders, we try to provide a very flexible environment. So, you know, when it's a question of someone coming in and saying, I need more resources, you know, it's a function of, okay, you know, either we'll add more capacity, or we'll, you know, we're always sort of planning for, like, how do we stretch, you know, to accommodate, you know, those sorts of things that they might need. And, you know, and storage is a big piece of that. So we need to be able to, like, you know, add more storage or add more capacity. It's more of like, you know, adding an additional node or a set of nodes to the cluster, scaling out the storage and that sort of thing.
So, I mean, the other side of the coin with scale is resiliency. Mm-hmm. How does that factor in, and how are you dealing with that as well?
I think from a standpoint of resiliency is that we try to make everything as commodity as possible, everything as standardized as possible, and so that we try never to make things, you know, so specific that an application's got limited resources, right? So we try to provide a lot of flexibility in our designs. And so that gives us some inherent flexibility. Of course, we add a lot of the other capabilities around observability, metrics gathering, all that sort of stuff to make sure we're taking an inventory of our systems and how they're functioning and things like that.
Yeah, I mean, this has got to be key learnings that you guys take back, and you know, again, with your new stuff coming out and all the announcements and everything like that you had earlier, I mean, you got to see this as a really just a key thing that you're learning from them about how they're doing it, because I mean, different industries have different requirements.
Yeah, you know, definitely different industries have different requirements, but I think the fundamental problems, you know, are kind of similar when you go from one industry to the other. I'll tell you, for example, you're talking about scale and resiliency, right? Now, you know, NVIDIA, especially this is a developer platform, a developer experience platform. Now, is it different from, like, for example, a payment gateway? Absolutely, yes. But you know, let's look at the fundamental KPIs and SLAs we need to drive. They have thousands of developers. They're building code constantly, right? And at the time of a release, like a chip tape out or a new software release, likely you're going to need more resources, but you're testing a lot more in parallel because you're trying to hit a timeline. So your underlying infrastructure has to be elastic and scalable, right? You could start off with something, but you need to be able to scale based on your need. Same thing with the payment gateway. You know, you could be obviously processing payments, but at the time of, for example, a Black Friday, your payment gateway need to be able to scale, right? So the underlying problems and scale is the same. Same thing with resiliency, right? You don't want an outage where tens of thousands of your developers are just sitting idle doing nothing, and that's the most expensive resource in your company, right? You don't want an outage in a payment gateway because you're going to affect millions of users not being able to make their payroll, right? So, but the outcomes and the effects can be different, but the underlying resiliency and the need for resiliency, need for scale is similar. So what we have learned, you know, from NVIDIA, what we have learned from other large banking customers, that's what has gone into the Portworx product significantly, right? And we have now extended that to not just, you know, this is all a container platform as a service use case, but we have extended that to virtualization, right? Where, you know, obviously our friends at Broadcom have jacked the prices up of VMware and a lot of people are leaving VMware. So Portworx now supports Kubernetes virtualization as well, and some of these learnings and some of these hardening that we did at scale, now customers with, you know, virtualization workloads can also benefit. If we can do this at scale at Kubernetes and containers where it's supporting tens of thousands of developers, trillions of dollars of payments, VMs is a much easier workload for Portworx to handle, and that's what we're extending it. We are announcing, as I mentioned in the previous session, Cube Data Stores, which is our latest innovation of delivering VM data store-like capability across, you know, Kubernetes virtualization. Yeah. We're extending, we are cementing our claim to be the de facto data management and storage layer for Kubernetes virtualization. We are going to extend our Cube Data Stores to do everything that VMware users are used to from it when it comes to data and storage management workflows, and of course extend it to similar to vSAN and VMFS, and solve end-to-end data management problems for VMs as well as containers.
So as you look out into the next 12 months here, 12 to 24 months for that matter, how do you see the business value you're getting today playing into that your container strategy going forward, and how do you see it looking, you know, when we're in Salt Lake? Because I found that out, we're going to be in Salt Lake in a year, so we're back to cold weather again, so maybe snow again.
I already like you calling this cold Atlanta.
I know, it's just like, I can't call it hot Atlanta today, that's for sure. But so where do you see your container strategy and how you're trying to get value, more business value over the next 12 months?
So, I mean, we're going to be updating and expanding in a number of areas. I'm being asked to deploy new K8s environments in other geographic locations, right? Some of those are more satellite, but there's still areas where you have development groups, things like that, right? So we're doing that, we're increasing that footprint. I'm asking to put more mission critical, like when I say mission critical workloads, like, so we were doing traditionally applications with sort of more simplistic stateful workloads. Now I'm being asked to put like multi-node Redis instances up across, you know, spanning 8 nodes, you know, with underlying storage. I'm looking at, we just POC'd you know, our Pure Array with cloud drives, storage as a way to like look at managed storage so we can add additional resources and flexibility under the storage layer. So when we're tending to expand and add capacity and resiliency and flexibility to the infrastructure. So that's really where I'm focusing my energy right now. And then making sure that we have the best of breed solutions in place to enable and evolve, right? Yeah,
I love that, I love this. Hey, thank you both for coming on board. This has really been great, and I think you had a lot of insights into that, and I think people can learn. Again, people have heard of your company, so if they can understand how you're doing it and supporting your organization, they can see it's possible. So thank you for coming on board today.
Thank you.
Thanks, as always.
Thanks for having us, Rob.
Yep. And thank you for watching this episode of theCUBE, live from KubeCon, CloudNativeCon, North America 2025 from Coldlanta. See you soon.